You ready? You're listening to the Real Pineapple Podcast Network. Good morning, ladies, gentlemen, theys, and gays. This is the Real Pineapple. This is your humble host, Hunter, here. Hope you're having a great night, day, weekend, whenever you're checking this out. I am so excited to have my guest on today, actress, model, author, director, who you know from several projects, including Baywatch, Starsky and Hutch, and The Nanny Diaries. I've got director of the new film Wineville here today, Brandy Roderick. Brandy, how you doing today?
I'm doing wonderful today.
Thank you again so much for making the time. So to jump into the interview here proper, I'm going to read you verbatim the note I took last night while I was watching Wineville, because I think this note kind of puts everything into perspective. Oh my God, redacted, because I don't want to spoil too much. Cut off that person's redacted and fed it to him. Oh my God, I'm too high for this. This movie is insane. That's a note I took around the... I took that note around the 45-minute mark. So yeah, I just want to jump into this. Where was your where was the inspiration for this movie, and when did you decide? Like, how early on in the process did you decide that you needed to be the one to direct this?
Well, it really started out with, well, I wanted to make a horror film. I knew that I wanted to be in it, and I knew that I wanted my son to play my son, my real son in real life. So I knew it had to be a story about a female character that would do anything to protect her son. And how it all started was, we had the location first. My friend is the owner of the Galliano Winery, which is the oldest winery in Southern California. And it is on Wineville Road in the town that used to be called Wineville, where the chicken coop murders happened in real life. So we went to this location. Although it is a beautiful winery, it was built in the early 1900s. So it really lends itself to being really creepy, you know, with all the old barns and all the old farm equipment and the big shears hanging all over the barn. So it had just these amazing, locations that where we could shoot. So Richard, the script writer, and I would go there and just try to, you know, we kind of started the story just from seeing the location and having the two start of the characters. And I knew I wanted to do a film that was very shocking and daring and not for the faint of heart, and just do things that people haven't done yet. Which you kind of just mentioned a little bit in your intro about the film, 45 minutes into it. So that was kind of the, that's how it all started. And then Richard and I just went back and forth with all of our story ideas. And I came up with all this crazy shit. And he's like, really, are you sure? And I'm like, yeah. And then he came up with this crazy shit. I'm like, really, are you sure? He's like, yeah. So we just kind of collaborated and came up with this really messed up story. I almost said the effed up story, but really effed up story.
I mean, yeah, you can cuss. Okay. So that was the thing that I found so fascinating, is that, and I want to get back to this, but I think what I love about the story in particular is that as I kept watching it, there kept being these layers that would stack on top of it that I really wasn't expecting. The way that you played Tess in particular, you feel such sympathy for her later on in the film as you learn more about her. And I think you do an incredible job of resonating that and getting that across. Without spoiling, can you talk to me about kind of her origins and the reasons you decided to go that direction? Because her origins, again, not spoiling, there's some dark shit in her background that I really was like taken back by, like in a good way, because I was impressed that you're willing to go there. But yeah, can you kind of talk to me about drafting that aspect of her?
Well, you know, she came from this horribly disgusting, abusive situation growing up as a young child, which started, back in the day. Her father, was abused, and her aunt was abused, and there's all this abuse within this Lot family that would ha that happened on this winery. And she was so severely abused that she had to run away at a young age, at 15 years old, ran away to Las Vegas. And at that point, she really had to do anything and everything to survive, if you can imagine the types of things a 15-year-old young girl would have to do in Las Vegas to survive. She had to do all of that. But then this one blessing happened, and she had this son, and that's what helped her to kind of get up back on, the straight and narrow, and try to build a different life for a son that she did not have. She did not have that kind of life. So that's kind of the background of what made Tess who she is, and the strength that she had to have to endure all of that. That's what made her the woman she was or is today.
And I think I think as we learn more about her, you definitely find yourself more endeared to her. I want to ask about you a little bit because this isn't a movie that, especially for a first time director as far as a feature film, I thought you did an incredible job with this. And I definitely was like watching, being like, okay, she's clearly a horror fan to go ahead and go this hard. There's a kill early on, like kind of the first one, that I actually was like it caught me so off guard in terms of like the actual content and how you filmed it. I thought you did a great job with that. What is your relationship with horror? Like, have you always been a horror fan? Is it something you kind of got into later on, or?
It really started for me. My first memory is my first horror film, being 6 years old, watching The Exorcist with my mother.
Oh shit,
And
okay.
my family is like really kind of sick in the head. They do crazy things. So watch The Exorcist. Then we would watch, I remember watching Rabid with my mom and dad, and I got up. We had this long dark hallway to go to the bathroom. When I came back, I was walking, and my dad actually was laying on the ground, grabs my leg, has foam coming out of his mouth. He put toothpaste in his mouth and was foaming at the mouth, grabs my leg. I mean, I was probably 10.
Oh my
And
God.
then every year I had my birthday party, we would watch a horror movie. Like, for example, we watched Sleepaway Camp, and then my dad would set
Nice.
up a tent outside in the backyard, and we would all go to sleep outside after we'd been out there almost asleep for a half hour. My dad would come out with the flashlight, banging and shaking the tent and all this crazy stuff. There was another time
Oh my
where my
God.
sister and I were in the house, and we just watched a scary movie, and my dad wasn't there. He comes around the back. All of a sudden, this guy comes in with a pantyhose on his head with a knife, banging at the door, coming inside. I mean, just shit like that. This is my upbringing, okay? So you
Wow.
can imagine why my film is so sick and twisted, because I really have.
Makes a lot of sense now.
Yes, but I mean, but it was such a fun, crazy childhood. We just loved horror. Our favorite holiday was Halloween. It still is. We always, all of us, even my parents, still get dressed up to this day. We love it. It's in my blood.
Now, do you go all out for Halloween? Like, are you going full decorations and like dressing up and all
I
that,
do.
or?
Yep, I do decorations. And up until last year, every year with my kids, we always did a theme, and we always dressed up together, like Stranger Things and Night of the Living Dead. Like, we've always come up with, we always did group things. But last year, they're like, "Mom, we're done. You have to do your own now. We're just dressing up in our football uniforms." So I was like, "What?" So I had a good running for about 12, 13 years of, us always doing a theme dress up. But I've always dressed up for Halloween. My parents, my mom, she always dressed me up in the coolest outfits that she made, which was awesome.
Oh yeah. Okay, so to piggyback off that, what's a horror film that you would recommend to someone that's a little maybe off the beaten path? Like, I'd recommend something like Like I'd probably go like Black Phone or like Tucker and Dale versus Evil. Like what's a horror movie you throw out to someone that
Well, I love Black Phone. And if we're talking about new movies, yes, 100% Black Phone. Oh my gosh, I love Black Phone. Another one that I love from that say, similar era is Barbarian. That is so good. I loved Barbarian. That is one that I really liked. I thought that was a good new movie. I somewhat enjoyed X because I love that 70s feel, right, that it gives you. And but if we're going to go a little old school, not Texas Chainsaw old school, but one movie that really got me when I was 14 years old, I was watching with my girlfriend and I had to spend the night in my parents' room on the floor for 2 nights and I
Oh,
was 14.
shit.
That's how scary it was. But for me, it was Nightmare on Elm Street. That just
Fair.
really got me because you didn't want to fall asleep. If you fall asleep, you're going to freaking die. So,
Yeah.
when you're watching slasher movies, Friday the 13th, Halloween, whatever, you can escape, you can fight back, you can physically try to save yourself. But when if you're falling asleep and you're in a dream, you can't protect yourself. So
Yeah.
it that shit is scary.
That's why I can't watch any of those. Like I just yeah, I like
So rough.
I'm slowly getting into horror. I'm actually gonna be watching it's weird. I've seen Ash vs. Evil Dead, but I've never seen Evil Dead or Army of Darkness yet. And I'm like, I need to knock those off the list. So I'm gonna watch
Yeah. Oh
yeah, so I'm gonna watch those for the first time next month.
my gosh.
So okay. There's one, so I mean, we kind of talked about it already a little bit in terms of the gore. And I appreciate that because if you're gonna do a rated R film, I think you should actually like commit to the hard R rating. Like give me the cussing, give me the swearing, actually earn your rating. Was that a discussion pretty early on in the process as far as like how hard you wanted to go in the paint as far as the gore? Because there's some amazing gore here. And considering I would imagine the shoot was pretty quick, I thought you hi doggy. I thought you nailed that aspect. But yeah, kind of talk to me about that conversation.
Yeah, because I didn't know exactly what makes a movie a PG versus an R. So I was like, oh, is it possible this could be a PG? Because in my eyes, I was thinking PG and R is like, oh, no nudity, so it's PG. I wasn't even thinking about all the gore because of course I am pushing the envelope as crazy as all get out. Then it became a point where, oh my gosh, is this going to have to be an unrated or an NC-17? But I wanted to make sure we could keep it at least like within the R rating. I didn't want to go too far where it couldn't be shown in certain places.
Yeah.
I mean, as you know, we go so far and show things.
Yeah, quite a
So
bit.
for me, I wanted to make sure that everyone could see it, but I also wanted to push the envelope as far as I could. I wanted to have that shock value there.
Was there anything that, in the sake of the rating, that you had to cut out, like cut out script wise or change script wise, that you're kind of like, damn, I wish we could have done that, or
No, I don't think so. I mean, no, we really pushed it. We
okay,
definitely
fair.
pushed as far as we wanted to, for sure. Yeah, we definitely did.
I want to talk about since you brought up that you your son plays one of your sons plays your son in this movie. I want to give him all the credit in the world because it's always one of those things where like kid actors, I feel like they're either like you're like, oh wow, they did a really great job, or you're like, oh, they're a kid, they're still figuring it out. I thought there's one scene in particular where he's learning about like cutting not flowers but cutting the rot out. And the way that he has this one facial expression when I don't want to give too much away, but someone freaks out about it, and the look that he has of like, okay, like adult, like they like he sells that in a way that I was like, okay, I appreciate that this kid isn't just pushing that aside. He's like, no, that's a red flag. Like,
Right.
kind of talk to me about directing him, because he really seems like a natural. I thought he did a really good job.
Yeah, I do feel that he is very, very natural. And he actually did work with an acting coach, Sandy Marshall. So he did work with her prior to coming to set, which really helped tremendously because when you're doing an independent film, you don't have time to be doing a million takes. You have to get it in your one take and then your one for safety, and that's all you got.
Yeah.
So I had to make sure he was prepared ahead of time. So by the time that we got to do the scenes together, it was just so natural, and it was written in a way that is very conversational for he and I, so that it wouldn't be, out of his element. So for me, it was just like I'm talking to my kid, like my real kid, and I was, and he was talking to his mom. So I feel that it was like really natural for him, to do the scenes. And then with the scenes with other people, he was just prepared ahead of time. And I think that really helped. And as a kid, it's easier for you to suspend disbelief and put yourself in that play, fake world. So I think almost it's easier for kids to act, in that sense that they know how to fake play, and to create, stuff in their heads. So I think that it was easy for him to put himself, immerse himself into that role.
Yeah, I thought he did a I thought he did an excellent job. Couple more questions. So the woman who plays your aunt in the movie, terrifying, terrifying,
Yes.
absolutely terrifying. That's a Carolyn Hennessy. Talk to me about casting her, because I think in horror. I think horror is very unique in the way that, especially if you're doing something like this, that if you miscast a role, everything kind of just folds within itself. And I think you nailed the casting for everyone. I want to get to the other people too. Talk to me about casting her and like what her audition was like and your chemistry of her, because, because there's this point early on where she called you like a harlot, I believe. And I just laugh because A, it's such an old school term, but B, like she's being such a bitch to you. And I found myself just off that wanting Tess to be okay. So kind of talk to me about her, because I just love her character.
It's so funny because during the casting process, it was tough when you start watching all the auditions coming in because honestly, everyone was good. Like everyone, all the auditions were really good. But when Carolyn's audition came in, it was like, holy shit, that's freaking Margaret, right? But the problem was, she's in real life, she's young and beautiful. Like if you go and you Google her, she's a young, beautiful woman. So we had to, like, I wanted her so bad because she just was so good. I had to call hair and makeup and say, can you make this woman look hideous? Can you make her look, 70 plus years old? Like that was, the goal. And they said, yeah, we can pull it off. So I was like, yes. So we called and gave her the role because she really, as you just saw, she is Aunt Margaret. She was so perfect for it.
Yeah, she absolutely nails that role. Being a first-time director, I'm always curious on this juxtaposition of that conversation that you have to have internally and then externally with your crew, as far as, hey, this is a script, trust the script, it's here for a reason, versus giving your actors and actresses like room to play and kind of improv. Where do you kind of draw that line, and how does that kind of vary between scenes for you?
Nobody, honestly, nobody ever wanted or tried to go off book, which for me, as an actress, I'm all for it. If somebody says, you know what, I don't feel my character would say it like this, they'd say it like that, I would be so open to hearing that because that's, I get it. But everyone came to set prepared and everything was on point and they got it done in one and two takes. So I didn't have that. Nobody wanted to or tried to change anything or improv. There were some great freaking amazing suggestions. For example, Carolyn Hennessy, she had to wear that wig, right?
Yeah.
And it wasn't a great wig. So she suggested, hey, to pull this off, you know, at the end. Wait, I'm giving away too much.
I was like, la 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 la. Ignore that, people. Ignore that.
She made a great suggestion that we used. And I thought it was a great suggestion. And I love it when actors, you know, do that. And
yeah.
It takes a seasoned actress to know, you know, hey, Brandy, this is going to work this way a little bit better. And I'm like, yes, I love that. So I was totally open to suggestions. And that was one in particular that everyone will find out when they watch it.
There you go. I do have to ask, just because I've seen him in a couple things, and I was like, oh wow, he's in this. You have the town sheriff in here, who's played by a Texas Battle, which is like the coolest name in the world too.
I know.
But you two have really great chemistry, and there's one scene in particular where you two get to talk. Again, going back to the little casting aspect, talk to me about their audition and like why he was the perfect actor to encapsulate that role.
Well, with Texas, as you can see, you know, just from his role, he's so genuine, right?
Yeah.
And so sweet and so real. And he's like that in real life. So we needed that character to really be that, that one comforting thing that Tess has, and that one good memory she has from her childhood, and that he's coming back into her life. So he really just embodied that sweetness that I really wanted the sheriff to have.
In terms of that, again, not giving too much away, but I thought it was a very interesting choice, and I wanted to get your thoughts on this. Was there ever a conversation of telling the story, I don't know how I want to phrase this, kind of more straightforward? Because I thought the use of flashbacks was really well done. And just the way that you kind of like, not even tease it, but Tess clearly has PTSD and she sees these certain things that like trigger it. I really like the way you did that. It felt very, very much like a shock to the system, to your senses, each time that you kind of referenced it until you reveal everything. Was that a conscious choice that you decided pretty early on, as opposed to telling it more traditionally? Or how did that kind of come about?
Well, in the story, in the script, Richard came up with wanting to do flashbacks to tell the story, which I fell in love with. But for me, I said, well, if we're going to do that, we have to make it look like it's on an old projector camera, because I had just seen, oh gosh, now I'm blanking on the name. Is it Sidious or?
Oh, Insidious?
The one with Ethan Hawke.
Oh crap.
It's so good. And they had the projector and,
a Sinister, right?
Sinister. I think that you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I had just seen them. Like, I love the projector. Every time I hear a projector, it's creepy. It got me. So it was really important to show the flashbacks as if it was a projector, because obviously the flashbacks were in the, you know, the 50s. So I really wanted that kind of projector feel, to be able to flash and tell the story and really jar you with what's going on.
Yeah. I thought that aspect, not to give this away, but there's a singing of a Bible verse kind of mixed in with that projector aspect that really creeped me out, that I thought you nailed. So like great job on all that front. Last question I have for you, being a first time director, like I said, I thought you did an incredible job with this. I've already done my review, which I'll definitely share with you, but is there a message, like, is there something that you want your audience to take away from watching this film once the credits roll? Is there one specific thing you want your audience to take away?
I want them to be completely and utterly surprised. Because when I watch a movie, I'm always trying to figure it out, right? You go through, oh, who's the killer? Who did, oh, he did this, you know? And in my film, I just want to make sure people are shocked and surprised throughout the entire thing. So they leave the theater saying, holy crap, I did not expect that. That's what I want people to take away. Because for me, that is what is exciting about a film, is when I can be surprised and shocked and I didn't get to figure it out. So I want people to like be shocked at the end.
As someone who watched it last night and then actually went back and watched, rewatched most of it again this morning, I will tell you that audiences will be shocked in the best way watching this. Yeah. Brandy, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me today. This is the start of my day, and this is a great start to my day. Aww. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Joshua. I really appreciate you, and I hope you have a fantastic rest of your day.
I appreciate it. Before I let you go, can you please tell people where they can watch the film and then where they can find you on socials, please?
Yeah, if you go to winevillemovie.com, it has a page that takes you where you can watch it. But, you know, Apple TV, Amazon, Google Play, iTunes, any of your cable networks, if you have DirecTV, Spectrum, Cox, whatever, you can, wherever you rent or purchase a movie, you can watch it. It's everywhere. So YouTube.
Perfect. And then where can they find you on socials?
My name, Brandy Roderick. And then also Wineville Movie. Follow Wineville Movie as well, please. So
done and done. Again, Brandy, thank you so much for the time. I hope this does well. I can't wait to see what else you direct moving forward. But again, thank you for making the time. This was an absolute joy.
Thank you.